When I first ordered the SV, I really wanted yellow springs for the shocks. However, at that time, the only option was red, and to get Lambo to do it in yellow was going to take a very long time. And me being somewhat impatient, I opted to forego changing the springs to yellow. But luckily, as time went on, Novitec introduced their springs for the SV, which are yellow, and they're a much better setup if you want to lower your car. But as many of you know, I'm not a huge fan of that because I always have problems, especially around here, getting in and out of gas stations, the same problems that you would experience, even though the SV does have the front lift. However, that being said, my friend Alex, who owns SP Engineering, purchased an SV and he lowered his car, and then I saw it and I just had to do it. So I decided to go ahead and move in that direction. And plus, the main bonus was is that the springs were yellow, which is what I wanted. And it's a more high-tech setup with a main and tender spring, much like a lot of race cars have. The next problem became, as many of you know, the part shortage. And even him, for his own car, it took a very long time. But luckily, he was on his game and he ordered me an extra set, not even asking him, because he was on back order for so long. So once they came in and I saw his car, he just knows me well enough that knew that I would take it. Let's jump right into it. The first thing I had to do was pull the hood, and I needed my lovely assistant Drew to give me a hand. As far as pulling the hood, I changed mine to a Eurotech Racing pre-preg carbon fiber hood. So I did a video on how to pull it. I'll put that up so you can take a look at that if you have any questions. But once the hood comes out, take the trunk out, that gives you access to the front suspension. Now, it's best to go ahead and pull the wheels and tires. For those of you that aren't familiar with the center lock, I have also done a video on the center lock system, and it's not very complicated once you get used to it. What you want to do is go ahead and pull the center cap. Then there's a special Lambo tool that all of you have that came with your car. Before you jump into it, you want to make sure you have the tool. So that video talks about a large 1-inch breaker bar, the torque wrench you'll need. I would check into all that. And if you don't have it, make sure you get it, because the last thing you want to do is be held up by not having the right tools. I'm going to pull the engine trim panels and also the grill above the exhaust, in the hopes that I'll get better access to work on the shocks. It's straightforward pulling them out. They're all held in by torque screws. Before I send the car up, I'm gonna go ahead and measure out to get a baseline. For that, I'll measure from the edge of the rim to the fender. The instructions from Novitec are very good. However, they don't really cover taking apart the suspension. So, in my particular case, I did it without the workshop manual because I'm still looking for a workshop manual. In case any of you do know where to source it, please comment down below. So I did the job the way that I thought would be the best and easiest for me. Now, whether or not that's correct, I don't know because I don't have that manual. But it did get the job done, and you can kind of gauge for yourself whether or not it'll work for you. I did the job first on the passenger side so I could see what I'm up against, but everything was fairly straightforward. You know, essentially there are three main bolts that you gotta deal with. There's one on the top of the shock on the inboard side, the base, and then the bolt on the outrigger. So there are three 12 millimeter bolts. You can use an 18 millimeter socket and wrench, whatever works for you. I loosened them all up and then I was able to kind of maneuver to pull them out. The one on the outboard side of the shock, what I did was I actually loosened the sway bar link and moved it out of the way. I actually left the other side open because I needed to move the sway bar when I was maneuvering the shock to get it out, okay? So then that, those three bolts come out, take out the sway bar. On the other side, I did disconnect the sensor, but the suspension is loaded. So even when the shock is disconnected, it didn't move. So on this side, I didn't actually do it. So I pulled all that out, disconnected the wiring harness, and then moved to pull everything out. Okay, so you can see right here, it was kind of a shuffle of moving the outrigger down, the shock on the outboard side, then lifting it up and pulling it out. Once you do it one time, it's pretty easy. Then after that, it's time to address working on the shock. There's a bolt on the inboard side of the shock that I actually raised up because on the passenger side, it actually comes down on top of the shock. So when I was trying to maneuver to get it out, I scratched it up a bit. So if you take a 13 millimeter socket, you can just back that out and bring it up far enough where it'll be out of your way. As far as the Novitec kit, it's top tier. All the parts are very high quality. The machine work is impeccable. The parts are also packaged very well. So everything arrived looking great. And as you know, that to me is very important because it shows that the manufacturer has a lot of pride in what they do. As far as the kit itself, well, it's very reasonable in comparison to a lot of the other kits I've seen and the quality you get here. Now, as far as tools, most kits I get don't come with tools. The very cool thing is it came with the spanners for the specific shocks, and also it comes with a tool to lock the shock shaft in place to remove the perch. Once the strut is out, the first thing that needs to be taken care of is the connector for the magnetic dampener. Okay, so what Novitec wants you to do is depin the plug. But once the plug is removed, what that allows you to do is pull the harness through the dampener eye. And that dampener eye has to come off to change the springs. But luckily, Novitec provides the tools that are necessary. So once you get the harness free, then you can go ahead and compress the springs if you like. I have quite a few spring compressors and none of them worked. Luckily, my good friend Gary Tireman, who makes his living on suspensions, has a wide variety of spring compressors, and he let me borrow one that I was able to make work on the SV. That's the way I did it. Now, Novitec, what they want you to do is actually release the lock and drop the perch all the way down. But since it's under load, I was afraid that I might damage the threads on the shock body, so I went ahead and compressed. Then that gave me enough clearance to use their tool to go on the top that locks onto the shock shaft. Once that's locked, you can free the dampener eye. Now, there's red Loctite on there, so how I did it was, for me, I used a 3/8 extension. It's about the right OD to fit through the hole, and then I used a dead blow while using Novitec's tool to hold the shock shaft steady, and that allowed me to get the dampener eye off. Once it was off, pretty straightforward, just disassemble everything. When disassembling the shock, you have to remove the ventilation disc. That way you can pull everything off. I used a brass punch and a plastic hammer to work my way around it. It was pretty easy. It popped right off and it didn't distort, so I was able to reuse it. That allowed me to get all the lower perch and the lock off and also put on the Novitec parts. I cleaned the shock and the shock body real well, especially the threads. Then I was ready to start assembling the shock. How I did that was I went ahead and put on the lower lock ring, the lower adjuster, and the lower perch. After that, I could put back on the ventilation disc and the new bump stop. Moving on, I put on the main spring, the separator, the tender spring, and the top perch. I then fished the wires through the washer, put that on the shock shaft, and then also fished the wires through the dampener eye. Now, I was able to compress the top perch because the tender spring is very soft, and start the dampener eye by hand. But when it got just above the washer, I went ahead and put a dot of red Loctite on it, and then I needed to tighten it down. I got as far as I could by hand. Now, what Novitec wants you to do is compress and put the tool on the shaft that would allow you to hold the shaft in place. What I decided to do was go ahead and put the tool through the tender spring. I was able to do that by using rubber on each side because the dampener eye was only going down a little bit. So then what I did was I used that 3/8 extension, turned it down, and was able to tighten it up. Now, as far as putting everything back together, well, just reverse all the steps. A few things I'll mention is, once you have everything tightened up on this side, you want to shoot back over to the passenger side, tighten up the sway bar link, you can close up the fender liner over there, but everything over here is just in reverse. And on top, you do have that one bolt that was pulled back, if you did it, to clearance the shock. You want to go ahead and bring that back down. And other than that, you are ready to roll on the back. Moving on to the front, I did start on the passenger side as well. Just wanted to go through a couple of things before I forget. The first is, in order to get the strut out of the front on the passenger side, I did have to pull the sway bar, which actually worked out well anyway for clearance, but it made things a lot easier. Also, when you pull the hydraulic line for the front lift, you want to be as careful as possible. I would actually recommend ordering a couple things to make your life easier so you don't get held up. Have some Totella CS Speed in stock, because that's what you'll need to refill the reservoir for the hydraulic lift. And the other thing is, the sealing washers that Lambo uses, mine got torn up, so it needed to be replaced. Unfortunately, Lambo or Dallas didn't have them in stock, and they had to come from Italy. So if you had those in hand, it would probably speed up your process or not delay you when you're putting it all back together. Now, in order to get clearance to pull that strut out of the passenger side, I did have to also remove the bleeder, and there was just enough room to maneuver it around the housing above, and I was able to get it out. So how I did it was I lifted up the outboard side in front of the outrigger, then moved the inboard side out and was able to snake it out that way. Now, let's go ahead and jump into the driver's side and see how it goes. I did also have to lower the bracket in order to not only pull the strut out, but also for the inboard bolt to get clearance to come out. So there were just two torque screws down below. All I did was loosen them and lower it down a bit to get clearance. I started by pulling the front and rear fender liner out. Now that's also a good time to address the side markers. I wanted to change to the clear side markers from Italy, so I had Lambo order those, and I was going to put those in at the same time, and you have all the access when the liners are out. After that, I moved on to the shock itself, but in order to do that, I did the same thing as the rear. I supported the suspension just in case it came down. Now, as far as working on the strut, I started with the wiring harness. Now on the front, there are brackets that are bolted in, and the easiest way for me to do it was go ahead and use a 10 millimeter socket, pull the bolt, drop the bracket down. That way I can pull the plug and disconnect the shock. After that, I was in good shape because the sway bar was already out, and the outboard bolt, which again is a 12 millimeter, you can choose an 18 millimeter socket and wrench on it to pull it out, was all clear. That was on the outboard side. I didn't have to do anything else to the outrigger. Then on the inboard side, it was just pulling the bolt. There's no nut on the back side. Once the hardware is removed and the strut is clear, I put rags underneath the strut to protect it. What I did was carefully pull toward the outboard side. That gave me enough clearance to lift up and over the inboard bracket, and I was able to pull the shock out. To get the strut out on the passenger side, I had to go ahead and lift the outboard side up and over the outrigger. That allowed me to pull it out. On the driver's side, there wasn't enough clearance above, so I pushed out towards the outboard side, towards the outrigger. That gave me enough clearance to go up and over because I didn't have a clearance issue like on the passenger side. Moving forward, once the front strut is out, the disassembly process starts. Depin the plug. Break the lower lock nut, I could bring it all the way down, then use spring compressor to compress the spring. Once the spring is compressed, that allowed me enough room to put in the Novitec tool to clamp onto the shock shaft and loosen the dampener eye. You pull the eye once it's free through the wiring harness, remove the washer and the bump stop. Once I had everything taken apart, I just cleaned everything thoroughly. After that was complete, I moved to remove the ventilation disc. Once the lower seal's out, I was able to take that and transfer it to the Novitec perch. Then I reinstalled the perch. Once the ventilation disc is installed again, then I could put on the new Novitec bump stop. I went to move to put the main spring, the intermediate spacer, and the tender spring on with the upper perch. I was able to compress this all by hand. That allowed me to put the washer back on for the dampener eye and thread down the dampener eye. I brought it down to about an eighth inch of the washer. Then I applied some red Loctite, put the Novitec tool back on the shock shaft, and tightened down the dampener eye. Of course, after this, take care of the wiring harness, then you're ready to send it all back into the car. Putting everything back together was just reversing the process. The only thing I will mention is that I did leave the hydraulic lines disconnected on both sides because to adjust the height, you need to turn the front lift system. So I left that undone. Everything is adjusted to the highest setting, at least for a baseline. Now I will say that I need to put in the sway bars and connect everything. Before I put the wheel housings back in, I'm going to go ahead and use that opportunity to install the clear marker lights. Now, I did get mine directly from Lamborghini of Dallas. It's a great time to do it because everything is wide open. I will say a couple things that popped up as I was doing the job. The first thing is that the lights came with the plug for the harness sealed with silicone. So I asked Mark why exactly that is, and what he explained to me was they're shipped that way from Europe. Once the marker lights are in, I'm all set to go ahead and put the wheel housings back in. And I'll say this, sometimes it's a real fight to get those back in, but on the SV, it was actually quite simple and straightforward. Just reverse the processes pulling them out. Okay, I'm getting ready to send the wheels up. So in preparation for that, the threads on the hub are to be lubricated by the Castrol Spec lubricant that Lambo recommends. Now to send up the wheels and tires, lock it down, you're ready to go. When you bring it down to torque, I always recommend double checking the locks, as that could be the place where you have some unforeseen issues that you don't want to deal with, such as tires coming off. Now that the wheels are back on, I can have Drew give me a hand to put the hood back on the SV. And of course, the next thing is dialing in the suspension. Some of you will remember that I've talked before about grease plates. They are just an amazing tool. And you would think that I just have my own, but I just don't do enough suspension work to justify. So I always borrow Gary's, which he is nice enough to let me borrow. For those of you that don't know grease plates, well, they are the best. Essentially what they do is when you come down on the lift, they allow the suspension to load and not be in a bind. That way you can adjust your height. Oftentimes when I don't have access to the grease plates, what I have to do is take the car off the lift, drive it around, so I get ride height, bring it back. It takes a very long time. Grease plates just make the job extremely fast. I dialed everything in, adjusted it to the height I wanted. As I go to adjust the ride height with the new suspension, I will mention a couple things. The rear, not a problem, because of course Novitec provides the spanner wrenches. The front, since it uses still the factory setup because the hydraulic lift is integrated into it, also the factory lock, it's pretty tight in there, especially once you're all set. So what I did was I found this 16-inch adjustable wrench. It was only around $100 off Amazon. That allowed me to work in the confines of the front area. I could have actually used that to take things apart as well, but at the time I didn't know I would need it. So hopefully that tip will help you out. Now that I have the front ride height where I want it, I will go ahead and reattach the hydraulic lines for the front lift. For the all important alignment, I'll shoot down to Gary's shop. As many of you know, he aligned all my cars, including the race cars. There was nothing super out of the ordinary with the SV. Gary is quick and everything went well in the alignment. There were only a few things that caught us off guard. We did have to drop the under tray so he could get to the lower shims, but other than that, everything went smooth. He was able to dial it in exactly the way I wanted it. Now for the $1 million question, would I do it again? Well, for me, yes, but I would say this. For those of you that happen to be closer to someone who's reputable, such as Alex who owns SP Engineering, they do these jobs all the time. Quite honestly, if I was closer, I would just pay to have it done. I mean, I love working on my own cars. That's why it was great for me, but it's a bit of a hassle. And honestly, they're fair in their pricing. It's probably easier just to have them knock it out and then you can go out and enjoy the car. You'll remember that I did recommend in the beginning of the video to have the ceiling washers in stock for the hydraulic front lift. Well, I will report that I did use my old seals because I was in a hurry. And they are leaking just a little bit, they're seeping. So I will have to change that over. So again, doubling back, probably would be a good idea to have them before you start the job. As many of you already know, when you modify your car, oftentimes there's a trade-off. And I will say in this particular case, the trade-off that I'm picking up on is ride compliancy. It does ride a bit more firm. For me, still livable, but something you'd want to consider if you're going to do the upgrade. Well, my friends, I hope that video will help you if you want to change or upgrade the suspension on your SV. Other than that, I'm going to close shop and head out to enjoy the SV. I hope all of you have a great weekend, and I'll see you next time.